We're back. We are back. We're 40 minutes past the hour and all blues. Little Miles for you. We're going back to our live line and to my next guest, a man whose credentials are above reproach, truly a friend of this program, a voice of reason for issues that impact the African-American community and the world at large. I can honestly say my good friend and my homeboy, Dr. Cornel West. Cornel, welcome back to the program, man, and thanks, as always, for going inside the issues.
Brother, it is always a blessing to be in conversation with you and our beloved parents there in Sacramento, California.
And I'm glad to say that your mom is recovering well and that all is good, and we continue to pray for the recovery, for the speedy recovery of your mother.
No, but thank you. Thank you, though, brother. Brother, what a wonderful son of Sacramento you are and continue to be. Force for truth and force for good.
Well, you blazed the trail, man. I sat and watched you. And so.
Well, you're very kind, though, man.
I sat and watched you. Let's get right, because I know time for you is always limited. So, first, the Zimmerman verdict. Your take on the verdict, but more importantly, your take on how the community is dealing with it. These discussions about boycotting Florida orange juice, boycotting the state of Florida, pressuring the Department of Justice to bring charges based upon civil rights violations. Give us your take on the verdict and how the community is moving forward.
Well, my starting point is always the precious tears of the struggling, suffering, shuddering parents. And I think Sister Sabrina and Brother Tracy have been elegant. They've been full of grace and dignity. And those tears, of course, are connected to the tears of every brother or sister of African descent who is shot by police every 28 hours. The tears are connected to those locked into the new Jim Crow. The tears are connected to those wrestling with massive unemployment, indecent housing, decrepit education. So to begin with, the tears is to keep it at the human level. Once we move to the legal level, we know, of course, America has a history of criminality in its legal system. Slavery was the law of the land for 244 years, almost 90 years under the United States Constitution. Jim Crow, another form of crime against humanity, another 90 years, U.S. law. So U.S. law is something I'm always suspicious of. The president tells me we're a nation of laws. I say, which laws are you talking about, brother?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You're talking about the laws that Wall Street criminals get away with, that the torturers get away with, that the wiretappers get away with, that drones dropped on innocent people in our name get away with? Or are you talking about the laws that have been traumatizing, terrorizing, and stigmatizing black people for over 350 years in America? Which laws do you have in mind? So that on the one hand, this is part of our history, but I love how you begin with the fight back. We fight back within the system, go to the Justice Department. I don't hold my breath with the Justice Department, but we have to put pressure on them.
Mm-hmm.
Fight against the laws there in Florida and the 29 other states, or the so-called standing your ground, which is nothing oftentimes but just a license to maim and murder the weak and the vulnerable. But also dealing with the new Jim Crow. See, right now, the major challenge is that we have to acknowledge that we've lost two generations of precious black brothers and some sisters, too, but especially the poor precious black brothers to the prison industrial complex that's tied, of course, to the decrepit educational system that we have and our community shattered with massive unemployment and the bullets flying and the drugs being sold on block after block. And that's the kind of awakening that's taking place. It's a beautiful thing to behold, my brother.
Well, you know, as I have watched the post-verdict analysis, listened to that and the actions, one of the things that I have found lacking in the dialogue is a discussion about how we got to where we are. Stand Your Ground is a law that was introduced into Florida through the think tank ALEC, the American Legislative Executive Council. ALEC is also responsible for initiating those voter ID laws. So if we're not discussing this Stand Your Ground in the context of how it got into the legislation in the first place, and understanding that we have to be more proactive
That's right.
on the legislative side. And for example, to me, anybody in I think it was Pinellas County, who's not registered to vote, really can't argue about the outcome of this verdict because they were never eligible to be on the trial, be on the jury in the first place. So if you're not registered to vote, then understanding that most counties get their voter pools from voter get their jury pools from voter law, voter registration, then you're out the game before the game even starts.
No, that's true.
So there are a number of angles from which we've got to start addressing this from. And again, ALEC and the NRA, looking at PNAC, the Project for the New American Century. So many of these think tanks that are doing the white papers, that are bringing the legislators into weekends to educate them on this legislation and instructing them on how they are to vote. If we don't understand that we have to play the game at that level, we are forever going to be reactive and not proactive.
No, I think you're making some very strong points there. It's just, I mean, the larger context is one in which, though, that both parties in some ways have had a bipartisan consensus against the criminalizing of poor black brothers and sisters. It was under Clinton that we got that vicious crime bill, let alone the welfare bill.
Right.
Often Democrats don't want to be soft on crime, as it were, and therefore go along with these very ugly and vicious laws that reinforce the criminalizing of poor black folk tied to the explosion, expansion of the population in the prison industrial complex. So that, yes, we at that legislative level, we have to be very, very alert, aware, and focus in. But we also have to recognize that both parties have so utterly failed us. And that's primarily because both parties have been vehicles for this. It's a class war that's going on. Mm-hmm. The people at the top, the well-to-do, oligarchs, plutocrats at the top, provide big money to both parties that constitutes the vehicle for them to get policies that reinforce their own interests and status and position. And so that we have to be cognizant of both parties being different when they are, and we have to be cognizant of both parties being similar when they are. And too often they are similar, especially when it comes to silence on poverty, silence on public education as opposed to privatizing public education, silence on decent housing as opposed to inadequate housing, and certainly a silence on massive unemployment. Now, we're going to see what the Democratic Party has to do in terms of this Trayvon Martin case. Right now, you know, they're talking strong, but, I mean, they tend to do that when they're in trouble, and then they fall right back into business as usual.
Well, in fact, let's go right to that's my next question. President Obama's initial statement, Attorney General Eric Holder's statement to the Deltas, in my opinion, both of those statements were very soft and noncommittal.
Absolutely.
For Eric
Absolutely.
Holder to say, you know, basically he went Bill Clinton on us. I feel your pain.
Exactly.
Well, I understand that, Attorney General Holder, but you know, give me something a little more substantive than I feel your pain. Now, before we get to your reply to this, I must say that the White House just released a statement from the president where the president, much to my surprise, has actually just come out with a very lengthy discussion about profiling and how and racial profiling and how so much of the frustration in the African-American community is being viewed through the context of racial profiling. And he talks about the fact that he himself has been profiled, and so he understands the basis of the frustration from that perspective. I was just quite surprised. I mean, this just came through about 10 minutes ago. I was very surprised to see that. But with that having been said, give me your take on particularly Attorney General Holder's statements in response to this.
No, I mean, one, it's interesting that Holder was first put out there all by himself, and he had to kind of say the major words representing the administration. And he did talk about, I can identify, I've been racially profiled three times, even one time when I was a federal prosecutor. But no serious talk about policy or whether, in fact, that policy was going to be fought for and enacted soon, let alone further down the line. Now, I mean, the president, it just hit me. You know, it was just, what, a year or so ago, he acted as if Trayvon Martin was his son.
Right.
And you say, well, you and I know, though, brother, especially given the parents that we come from, high-quality parents we come from, that when your precious boy is murdered and the murderer walks free, you don't say this is a nation of laws and the jury has spoken.
Right.
That's a poor parent.
Mm.
It's a very poor parent.
Mm.
You see, so in other words, don't play games with us. Don't act as if he's your son at a particular moment, and then when the rubber really hits the road, you're not a good parent at all. He's not really your son.
Mm-hmm.
Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
Not at all. A father has righteous indignation. A father knows no matter what the laws of the nation are, when those laws are unjust, you call them out to be unjust. A father knows that when you have a verdict that is wrong, you don't tell people to respect the verdict. I hated that among this, what I call the rent-a-Negro crowd on MSNBC. All of them got to start off, I believe this is the best system in the world, and we must respect the verdict, but this is something we got to fight. No, how can this be the best criminal justice system in the world if it destroyed two generations of black poor folk, and you got a racist verdict, and we find out you got racist jurors, too?
And you find out that data shows you that when, as soon as you inject an African-American into the jury, you get You stand a great chance of getting a different outcome.
A very different outcome. It's a racist system. Why don't they go in and tell the truth? I know they got to protect their careers and position and wealth and everything. Tell the truth. From the vantage point of the masses of black people, the criminal justice system is itself criminal. And any community would say that. If it happened to the white community, the Jewish community, the Catholic community, if they had the same numbers of mistreatment, of murders vis-a-vis the criminal justice system, they would say it. But we end up with our middle-class spokespersons talking about, well, it's still the best in the world, and we have to respect the verdict no matter what it is. No, we don't respect the verdict. We didn't respect the verdict when the innocent folk walked away from Emmett Till's murder. It was wrong, immoral, and unjust, and we have a right to say that. But what we have, though, brother, we have what I call the re-niggerization of the black professional class.
Mm. Well, as your good friend and now my good friend, Dr. Tony Monteiro, refers to the misleadership class.
The misleadership class. But it's a historical process.
Mm-hmm.
Never in the history of black people have we had so many upper middle class, upper class black people with so much wealth, power, status. But never in the history of black people have we had so many black middle-class people and well-to-do people so afraid, intimidated, deferential to the powers that be, subservient to the status quo. Never, ever. Our black middle class has always, oftentimes, distanced itself from the black poor, but they never were so afraid that they wouldn't speak on behalf of the whole group, even if they didn't necessarily associate themselves spatially and socially with the black poor. So that the Dorothy Irene Heights and the Martin Kings and all, they all come out of the black middle classes, and they may not have lived right next to the black poor, but they knew the black poor was still part of the black community, and when they fought, they were lifting as they climbed. Now we got a black middle class, black upper class, black well-to-do, who are so afraid from the powers that be that they not only distant from the black poor, they render the black poor invisible. That's why you got a black president can't say a mommy word about the black, about the new Jim Crow. Can you imagine having a black president in 1948 that couldn't say a word about Jim Crow? Well, new Jim Crow is vicious. The old Jim Crow was vicious. And people say, well, how can you be critical of the president? Lead the president out of this. He ain't got nothing to do with this. It's not just the president. The criminal justice system being criminal was in place before he got there. But if he's going to move to the highest level and be the most powerful person in the world and can't say a mumbling word about the new Jim Crow, and we're not even talking about putting $2 million bounty on Sister Assata Shakur.
Right, right, right.
Out of all the folk in the country, 1,100 white supremacist militia?
Well, it's funny you mention that because one of the things, and we're heading into a break, one of the things that people say to me all the time is, what do you want the president to do? And my response is, the first thing I want him to do is use the bully pulpit.
Absolutely.
And articulate the issues as they are.
Absolutely.
And
educate the country.
And unfortunately, he's lacking severely in that regard. Let me say, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Wilmer Leon here. We're at 57 past the hour. My guest, Dr. Cornel West, and we're talking about the Zimmerman verdict. We're going to get into a couple other issues that are all related to this. And stay with us. He's going to give us one more segment. So a whole lot more in store. Do yourselves a favor. Keep it locked right here. SiriusXM 110, The Urban View, my Facebook fan page, Dr. Leon's Prescription, Dr. Leon's Prescription at Facebook.com. Dr. Wilmer Leon here. You're going inside the issues here at the top of the hour. SiriusXM 110, The Urban View. Go to my Facebook fan page, Dr. Leon's Prescription. Dr. Leon's Prescription at Facebook.com and like the page. My guest, who's staying over for one more segment, and I truly, truly appreciate, because I know his time is incredibly precious and limited. Dr. Cornel West is staying with us. Cornel, man, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, though, brother.
When we were going into the break, I was making a point that people, particularly in the African American community, will say, "Well, what do you want the president to do?" And I always say, "Well, the first thing I want him to do is use the bully pulpit to articulate these issues and educate us." And
absolutely.
He has yet to say anything, to my knowledge, about the Jordan Davis trial, which is coming up next in Florida. Another brother shot by a white man for playing his music too loud in broad daylight.
And it's not only that he won't say a mumbling word, but when he comes to New York City, Carl Dixon, myself, and others on our way to jail because of the stop and frisk policies, nothing but criminalizing poor and black and brown brothers. He says the mayor is a terrific mayor. Terrific, the same mayor who is actually stop and frisk millions during his three terms. Now we're told that Raymond Kelly, who, of course, police commissioner in New York City, who is the exhibition A of racial profiling in America, head of Stop and Frisk, is now on the top of the short list for being head of Department of Homeland Security.
And when you look at the data, and again, you and I are both data-driven individuals, when you look at the data on Stop and Frisk in New York, what you find is of the millions that have been done, almost 80% of those have been African Americans and Latinos in the African American and Latino community. And I want to say about 70% of those have resulted in absolutely no arrest,
nothing
no
whatsoever.
Fine,
that's
no
right.
Nothing.
That's right. It's just systematic harassment, humiliation, and trying to render folk afraid and intimidated, you see. So that on the one hand, even when he puts out some talk about I've been racially profiled, okay, but what about the millions in New York City? And you're going to say the mayor who was supportive of this is a terrific mayor? You're going to say that the Raymond Kelly, who's a police commissioner, somehow is the going to be your next head of Department of Homeland Security? What are we talking about?
Well,
it's at the level of praxis that it's most important.
There you go,
brother.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Mm-hmm.
In too many instances, the president talks about one thing does something
and
totally
moves the other way.
It was reported that you launched 6 tweets late Monday, and you addressed a number of issues. And I say reported because I just always want to be sure that the tweets are coming from those who they reported.
No, they came from me.
Okay, and one of them, and I love the way you did this, and I'd like for you to expound on it or expand on it here. You said, is Obama as committed to justice for Trayvon as he is to prosecuting Bradley Manning and Edward Snowden?
That's right, because it's fairly clear that when you violate international laws, which is really a kind of a act of war, and turning back the plane of President Morales from Bolivia, won't allow his plane to go through the airspace of your allied countries because you think Edward Snowden is on the plane. That's what I call commitment. The president is fundamentally committed to capturing brother Edward Snowden. Mm-hmm. Now, will he exert that kind of commitment for justice for Trayvon, not just justice for Trayvon, but I'm also thinking about all the other brothers and sisters who get railroaded, murdered, maimed every day, that every 28 hours that's taking place. Let's see that kind of commitment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't see it. And that's the kind of hypocrisy that I can't stand. But also when I talk about the re-niggerized black professional class, too, that a lot of them know deep down in their hearts that is wrong, but they won't say it because they're afraid they won't gain access to the president, access to the cocktail parties, access to status and position and wealth vis-a-vis their jobs and careers by remaining silent in the place of not just in the face of not just the president, but the status quo and the administration as a whole. The only thing they can do is trash Republicans. That's it. And the Republicans need to be radically pushed against the wall, but it's not just Republicans. It's Democrats, too, and sometimes it's Democrats who look like us.
You tweeted, will the Obama apologists now admit the sad truth about his pathetic words and actions for black and poor people? You, of course, have that's been a great bit of this conversation, but I just wanted to make the point that you tweeted that as well. Will our colorblind president ever wake up? You know, there are those who said, oh, in the second term, boy, once we get a second term.
Oh, he's going to throw down in the second term. We don't have to worry about reelection. He's going to be his real self. You watch him come out swinging.
Well,
I said, Lord, that's like waiting for Curtis Mayfield to show up on the stage, and here come Pat Boone and Brown, brother. He said, oh, please, give me Curtis, man. Give me a little bit of Curtis.
Yet the murder of over 200 innocent children by U.S. drones is also criminal.
That's right.
That has gone just been conspicuously not discussed. In fact, I remember listening to Reverend Sharpton try to justify the use of drones in foreign countries, and now we know that drones are that technology and that practice is being applied here as well. In fact, I want to say it was in Colorado over the last week. One county in Colorado just approved drone hunting. That if you see a drone in the sky, you're authorized by the county to shoot it down. I found that to be rather amusing.
My God.
But anyway, go ahead and talk about that.
But for me, at a spiritual and moral level, though, that it's just wrong, immoral, and unjust to ever kill an innocent person, let alone an innocent child. And there's been over 200 innocent children killed in Yemen, Somalia, and Pakistan by U.S. drones in our name. And that innocent child in Pakistan killed by us has the same exact status as the children in Newtown, children in Brown Barrios, children on indigenous people's reservations, children in black ghettos, children in Brown Barrios. Trayvon Martin himself, he has his life, as rich and priceless as it is, has the same value as the innocent child in Pakistan. That's my Christian faith speaking, brother. And that's what makes me an internationalist. That's what makes me a universalist. I always begin on the chocolate side of town, but it doesn't end there, because when you're talking about truth and justice, it holds for everybody. And so on the one hand, if we get obsessed with innocent folk just in America, and yet we succumb to policies that killing innocent folk and innocent children in other parts of the world, we become morally bankrupt and ethically inconsistent, too.
You know, two things. One, I was having a conversation with my a good brother, friend of mine who edits a lot of my op-eds, and I mentioned to him that I was coming in here to do this interview with you, and we got to talking about you, and I said, you know, one of the things, whether you agree with Cornel or not, it's hard to argue his logic, and my buddy said, and he is always consistent. And I said, well, he's consistent because the basis of his arguments comes from a moral background, and my buddy said, a Christian ethos that keeps you consistent.
No, it's true. Jesus loves the little children, all little children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They're precious in his sight. I vacation Bible school, Shiloh Baptist Church, 9th Avenue, Oak Park, chocolate side of Sacramento. You know what I'm talking about.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
And I believe that. I might have wrestled with other aspects of Christianity and so forth, but I believe that at the core. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And not only that, but see, that's what kept black folk going anyway. That's at the best of our music. That's what Stevie Wonder's about. That's what John Coltrane's about.
Uh-huh.
That's right. What that Miles was about in his music. He may have been acting a fool in his life. Listen to the music. The music itself. Listen to the voice of David Ruffin.
Mm-hmm.
It's that militant tenderness. It's that subversive sweetness. It's that revolutionary gentleness in the voice that's tied to the love that allows us to take a stand and try to be morally consistent against overwhelming odds. And that's been our history, brother.
You know, I was watching Meet the Press a couple of weeks ago. It might have been a month ago. Tom Brokaw was on. And he said something that, to me, was so profound and went over the heads of David Gregory and everybody else on the panel. They were talking about drones.
And
Tom Brokaw said, I've been traveling the world, and when I go to Central Asia, when I go to the Middle East, the message is always the same. People tell me, I love America, but if you harm one hair on a family member of mine in a drone attack, I will commit my life to addressing that attack. And so with that, what is being said is we are creating more terrorists than we are eliminating.
That
very simple point seems to be overlooked by so many in the analysis.
And you look at it the other way. I mean, do unto others, you'd have others to do unto you. We've got war criminals in the country. Kissinger, Cheney, Bush, we can go on and on. I go all the way to the president. Can you imagine if somebody whose kids they have killed or their policy resulted in the killing of their kids sent drones back over to their house?
There you go.
And then killed them? What do you think Americans would do? Oh, man, we the cowboys of the universe. Man, we come out swinging.
We come out swinging,
and then we get upset when they get upset that we've killed their innocent children, yet they don't have drones to come back on us. See, we don't want either one. We don't want either crime against humanity, be it the United States committing it or being committed against us. But we remain too silent, though, brother.
I wrote a piece a couple of weeks ago when I heard former Vice President Cheney called Edward Snowden a traitor.
Oh, my God.
I wrote a piece called Dick Cheney the Pot Calling the Kettle Black.
That's exactly what it is. That's exactly. And you see, Brother Snowden came right back and said what? The highest honor he could imagine is being called a traitor by Cheney. And he's absolutely right, though. But, you know, the thing is, the Black Freedom Movement, I think in many ways still serves as a kind of model for the human freedom movement. That's why I consider Edward Snowden and Bradley Manning the kind of John Browns of the U.S. national security state, because they're willing to actually give their lives for something bigger than their lives, which has to do with the truth about the American empire and justice in the American empire. Same would be true with Glenn Ford, Bruce Dixon, Margaret Wimberly, Nellie Bailey, Chris Hedges, mm-hmm. Glenn Greenwald. They are the Lloyd Garrisons, the William Lloyd Garrisons mm-hmm. of the U.S. National Security State. Because William Lloyd Garrison, as we know, did what? He, as a journalist, said, I'm going to stand in the face of the U.S. law, stand in the face of U.S. lies, and highlight the truth and justice as part of the anti-slavery movement. And we have to just lift those folk up, even though at the moment they are not that popular.
I had a conversation with my son just yesterday about Edward Snowden, and my son said, Daddy, but he violated the law. And I said, well, son, at times you have to make a decision for yourself.
That's right.
About right and wrong, and just because it's law doesn't mean that it's right. And I said, in fact, what Edward Snowden did was tell the American people that its government was violating its own law.
That's exactly right.
I said, but when you make that decision, you also have to be prepared and understand what the consequences
are. That's right. That's right.
And he said, oh, okay. I mean, he's 11, but I said, now, that doesn't work in this house. You better don't think.
No. But the thing is that your loving parenting is connected to his well-being.
Oh, no question.
Whereas this other law is not connected to the well-being of the folk being criminalized. You see, and so you rightly point that out in a powerful way. But I think in a way it still comes down to courage. You see, right now we live in a land of dollars and smartness. Everybody obsessed with chasing dollars and trying to get over. So the courage, integrity, virtue. You remember what the great W.B. Du Bois wrote 89 years old, page 275 in that first novel, The Ordeal of Manzart. He says, how shall integrity face oppression? What should honesty do in the face of deception? What does decency do in the face of insult? How shall virtue meet brute force? He says, those are the questions I wrestle with all my life. Well, you know what? 2013, same issues. Same issues. Go. Integrity in the face of oppression. Honesty in the face of deception. Decency in the face of insult. Virtue in the face of brute force. That's the history of black folks. So, at our best, not at our worst, because at the worst, we gangsters and thugs and sellouts like any other peoples.
So, in closing, and you are really at the forefront, you and Tavis tend to be at the forefront of taking the brunt of this from the misleadership class, from those sycophants of the president who want to say, how can you challenge him at this point in time? So talk to us, where do you get your strength from? And when you lay your head down at night, where do you find your peace and solace as you grapple with these issues every day?
Well, my dear brother, I believe in ancestor appreciation, so that when I think of the Frederick Douglasses and the Harriet Tubmans and others, they were never popular, not even among black people, because the niggerized people are always afraid of the folk who are de-niggerized, who are full of fire, full of courage, want to speak the truth, but the truth can hurt too much. But you don't put the folk down. See, I don't put black people down. Black people are worthy of love because they are who they are.
Mm-hmm.
You don't love folk in order to be popular among them. And of course, as a Christian, that for me holds for everybody. And so I welcome the critics because I need to learn. I'm faulty and full of foibles, too. I do need to learn. But I will not be deterred. I will not be disempowered. I won't be paralyzed. I won't be debilitated by the trashing and the demonizing at all. Because as long as I know that I'm tied to the best of the ancestors and still, as a Christian, have some connection to the best of my ability, to a God who sits high and looks low, is concerned about the least of these, then I'm able to go on. Then I turn on my Curtis Mayfield and Luther Vandross and Bob Marley and Nina Simone and keep moving, brother.
Wow, that's some powerful stuff, man. That's some very, 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 very powerful stuff.
But brother, you do exactly the same thing. You do the same thing, man. And the wonderful thing is, more and more young folk are waking up and they doing the same thing.
Well,
they may
know,
not necessarily listen to Luther Vandross. They can turn on a little Andrew Stone and Jill Scott. That's cool too.
Well,
that's,
you
beautiful
know,
too.
You know what I have come to try to implement and try to emulate is a comment that Dr. Walters gave in class.
Oh, the great Juan Walters, the great Juan Walters, my God. Yes.
I asked him one day in class, I said, Dr. Walters, how come you don't have a show? And he laughed and he said, Wilmer, I've had more offers of shows than you can imagine. He said, but when I go to sign on the bottom line and they realize that I will not compromise my principles,
the shows
go away.
God, isn't that true?
And then he looked at us and he said, as my students, don't you ever compromise your principles. And,
yes.
And I've had a number of people say to me, you know, I could be getting the big interviews. I could be getting the president on my program, but I've come to just to decide if it means that I've got to compromise.
That's right.
I'm not willing to do that. I don't care about the access so long as I've got the microphone. I don't care. And if I lose the microphone, I'll always have a pencil and a piece of paper.
But better, that's part of the ancestor appreciation. The great Ron Walter, just heard Sister Patricia on Joe Madison's show the other day, to keep his memory alive, that part of his afterlife is manifest in your life, in your deeds, in your thoughts, in your praxis. It's a beautiful thing, man. I mean, that's how you keep a tradition alive. We wouldn't be the people that we are without that tradition, man.
And whether it's the classroom in Howard University.
That's right.
Or South Land Park Drive.
That's right.
Following in your footsteps, that's what we do.
Well, there's a lot of other footsteps, but we all stepping in the name of love together, brother.
Hey, man, look, I know your time is short and precious. I want to thank you so much for all that you cut out and provided for us today. And look forward to it again and again, man. We're keeping your mother and her speedy recovery in our prayers.
Thank you so much. Love and respect you, brother. Stay strong now.
All right. Hey, folks. Dr. Wilmer Leon here, going inside the issues here on Sirius XM 110, The Urban View. Go to my Facebook fan page, Dr. Leon's Prescription. Dr. Leon's Prescription at Facebook.com. Coming up on what, 17 past the hour? Is that what we're coming up on here? 18? Well, coming up on 20. There you go. Time flies when you're having fun. Coming up on 20 minutes past the hour. Again, my Facebook fan page, Dr. Leon's Prescription. Dr. Leon's Prescription at Facebook.com. That was Dr. Cornel West, and he was so gracious to give us that time that he gave us today. And, man, always love rapping to that brother. And, yes, we did grow up in the same neighborhood, and must be something in the water in South Sacramento. Anyway, a little more Miles Davis. Do yourselves a favor. Keep it locked right here, Sirius XM 110. The power. The Urban View. Golly, the Urban View. And it's powerful.